morning and welcome to Indian Creek Sunday School. Title of our lesson today is Faith of the Persistent. Our quarter title is Examining Our Faith. And our unit title is The Measure of Faith. It's coming from Luke chapter 5, verse 17 through 26. Let's have a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for all that you have done and all that you will do. God, we know that you're a merciful God. We know that you do no wrong and you see all. And the Lord, we ask you to be with us as we go throughout this lesson, throughout this day. The Lord, we ask you to be with us in our daily lives, that we'll be stronger Christians for you, the Lord. We ask you that those that don't know you in the pardon of their sins, the Lord, that they will come to a relationship with you, and that, Lord, that we can be, us Christians can be living examples to those in the world of how great a God that you are. In the merciful name of our Father, in Jesus' name we pray, amen. So in today's lesson, like I said, we're continuing to talk about faith. Today's lesson is specifically about persistent faith. A little bit of background. Our lesson today is in the book of Luke. And we know all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The other three were written by disciples. But Luke was actually a physician, and he was traveling with the Apostle Paul. So his account of the things that happened during Jesus' ministry is really secondhand. He was not actually a witness to these things, but he was in the he got it secondhand knowledge. And a lot of people kind of think that he probably got a lot of his information from Mark, because his account parallels. Today's lesson takes place in the town of Capernaum, which is about 80 miles north of Jerusalem in Galilee. And Jesus is early in his ministry in today's lesson. He had gotten quite a bit of following at this point. This is very early in his ministry, but people have heard what Jesus was doing. They had heard about his teaching, so he had drawn a crowd. He had drawn a crowd of people, and not only people that were wanting to be healed or wanting to hear his teachings, but also those that were just curious. He just had some curiosity, and the people that were curious, we know from Scripture, are like the Pharisees, which were the religious rulers of the time, and scribes and Sadducees and all these people. And they wanted to just, they wanted to hear what Jesus had to say. So we'll go into our the reading of the first outline today. It's entitled Faith That Seeks. And that's going to be the first four verses of Luke chapter 5, verse 17 through 28. All right. And it came to pass on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And behold, men brought in a bed a man which was taken with palsy, and they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went upon the housetop and let him down through the tiling with his couch and into the midst before Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he said unto him, and we're going to stop right there for a moment. All right, so first we see here, let's say Jesus is in Galilee in Capernaum, and he's a certain day, and the Pharisees have been following him around, trying, I wouldn't say to trip him up, but they wanted to make sure he was following all of the rules of the day. You know, there were laws about the Sabbath, and there were laws about who could do what, and they wanted to make sure that Jesus was legit. Is how I would put it. They were checking his legitimacy, so they were following him around. So they were sitting by in this home in Galilee, and verse 17 just really sets the scene. And it says, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. So I think Luke inserted that at the end of verse 17 to let us know that, you know, Jesus already had that. Jesus had the power to heal at this point. And he's early in his ministry, but he's already healed others. And the power of the Lord was upon him. Now, mind you, the time early in Jesus' ministry and all throughout this his life, the Jewish people are under Roman rule. So, and they were expecting a Messiah. They were expecting a Messiah that could come and rescue them from Roman rule. But Jesus came to what? To deliver souls. He came to deliver souls and to cleanse sins, correct? So Jesus being there, he was not what they looked like. That's not what they thought a Messiah was going to look like. When he's telling them he's a Messiah, that's not what they were thinking. So in verse 18, it says, and behold, men brought in a bed and a man which was taken with palsy, and they sought means to bring him in and to lay before him. So we see this man. This man has what? This man is paralyzed. This man is he can't walk. He's crippled. And so it says he was taken, and his friends, he had, we know from Mark's account that there were four friends. So imagine them, you need to visualize with me that there's a bed or a cot, and you have four friends, one on each corner, carrying this man in to try to see Jesus. But the crowd is so big that they can't get in. They can't get in through the front way. And so and we see in verse 19, it said, when they could not find by which way to bring him in, that they went up on the roof. Now, interesting, in Palestinian homes back in that time, the roofs were flat. You didn't have, like, you know, the arch roofs like we have, and with the tall. They just had leaves and thickets on top to cover them from the weather and the sun. So these people, his friends, they went up on the roof. So to me, the first thing I think about is that they had a plan. They said, if we can't get in one way, we'll go another way. But the thing we see here is that they had faith. They had faith to, okay, if I can't get to Jesus this way, I'm going to go another way. So they went up on a roof in the housetop, and I can imagine Jesus and the Pharisees and everybody that had came to hear him that day, they were all looking up, what's going on? Like, as they start moving the tiles off of the ceiling to lower him down. And think they had to have some, preparation prior to, because you had to have some kind of rope to lower him into the room. They had to have, you know, some manpower to move those tiles out of the way. So they had to have some preparation, which also speaks to their faith, because they knew that they was going to get him to Jesus one way or the other. So we see right here, and one thing that's important to me to note is your circle matters. This man not only had faith to try to get to Jesus, but also his friends had faith. His friends had faith to take him to Jesus. All right? And so now they're in the room. and they're about to lower him in down into the house where Jesus is. And it says in verse 20, we see, it says, and when he saw their faith, he said unto him, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. So he came, you know, this is the real counterpoint right here. You see, Jesus says, your sins are forgiven thee. He's coming for a physical healing, you know. He's coming, he wants something to be done about his lameness, his paralyzed condition. But as we know, Jesus knows all, and he looks at the inner of man. He looks at us as our inner man. Just like our outward appearance, you see, oh, they have this problem, they have this problem. But no one knows, but Jesus, you know, that, you know, God knows what the inner is. So he sees that the man is also what? His sins need forgiving. Because he needs to forgive he needs to deal with his sins before he can heal his physically. And so what is that a lesson to us? A lesson to us that before we go to God asking for healing or a physical ailment or to do something else, we first need to be forgiven of our sins and our shortcomings, right? We have to deal with that sin prior to getting, you know, asking God to be a genie, to do this and do that for us. We need to have our heart cleansed. And that's where we are right here. And the man is having his sins forgiven, and that's not even what he came for. He's not even what he came for. All right. Now we'll go to our second outline. Our second outline today is faith that finds. And that's going to be verses 20b, starting right there through 26. And as he says, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And the scribes and the Pharisees begin to reason, saying, who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answered, saying unto them, what reason ye in your hearts? Whether it is easier to say, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, rise up and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he said to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy couch and go into thine house. Immediately he rose up before them and took up that whereon he lay and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed, and they glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, we have seen strange things this day. All right, so as I was saying, this man came for forgiveness. He came to be healed, but he's now received forgiveness. And this causes the Pharisees to become, you know, they were already there in a let's see what Jesus is all about kind of thing. So as soon as this happened, they know the law, they know the scripture, so they know that only God can forgive sins, right? So they start reasoning. I can imagine some of them are muttering to each other, can you believe he said that? Can you believe what is he doing? He's forgiving sins. Who does he think he is? But here he is. But Jesus perceives that what their thoughts are, whether they voice them or they make some interaction. He said, who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? So they actually say to him, who can, only God can forgive sins. Why are you blaspheming? You know, so that's that, that, that they're they're wondering about why Jesus thinks he's all that and he can forgive sins. Of course, we know that he had divine power, but they were really about to find that out. But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he said unto them, "What reason ye in your heart?" So, like, he could see what they were thinking. He could see what they were thinking. And Jesus knows what we're thinking all the time. He knows our thoughts, and that needs to make us think how we need to train our thoughts to be, because Jesus knows what we're thinking, even when we're whether we question something or we have doubt, God sees that. Jesus, you know, we have to keep our hearts clean. It says, whether it's easier to say, "Thy sins be forgiven thee," or to say, "Rise up and walk." So he asked them a question. He didn't even give them an opportunity to respond. And he says, is it easier to forgive sins or easier to make somebody get up and walk? Because that was what the friends came, brought him to be healed physically. But Jesus is saying, no, you need to be healed spiritually first. And we need to always remember that our spiritual needs to be right just as much as our mental, as our physical. And I'll go a step further to even say our mental. You know, we need to be right spiritually, and then the rest can follow. So Jesus is questioning. Here's another thing Jesus did boldly. He is questioning the religious leaders of the day. These people are supposed to be, I mean, these are the pastors and the deacons and the people that are in charge of the church at the time. And Jesus is saying, what's easier then? You know, he questioning them, but we know that he was really the master teacher, but they felt like they were following the Mosaic law and all that. That was the master thing. That was the thing that should supersede anything. And they're like, man can't heal, only God can heal. But he's about to show them that while he's forgiven this man's sins, he has supernatural power. But in verse 24 it says, but they that ye know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins. He's talking to the man that's paralyzed right now. And he says, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy couch and go into thine own house. So this man, I can imagine Jesus thinking, I said, he's sitting around here and he's thinking, these people need a real show. They're not just a show, just to, since they're not believing me when I forgave the man's sins, let me go a step further and just speak this man into rising up and walking. And this man, we don't know how, the scripture doesn't tell us how long he's been with the paralyzed or how long he's been on this bed, but we can imagine it's probably been quite a long time. And Jesus just speaks it into existence and says, grab your bed and get up and walk to your own house. And there are several occasions in the Gospels where we see Jesus talking to, just speaking things into his existence. He speaks to the leper, you know, and cleanses him. You know, he has the woman with the issue of blood. You know, she just touched the hem of his garment. You know, the supernatural power that Jesus possesses. But going back, what? The man, he had faith that he could be healed, right? And we have to have that faith in ourselves. That's our lesson today, is about persistent faith. And I can imagine, like I said, one way was blocked, so they went another way. how many times have we been blocked and we say, well, it's just not for me, and just gave up? You know, these people, one was blocked, they went on the roof, and they were lowered down. So I feel like this is a lesson for us that we need to be persistent in our faith. We need to always be attempting to, no matter what happens, I must get to Jesus. I must get to Jesus. I must find out what Jesus is, what Jesus can do for me. I need to get to what Jesus has for me. I can't stop because I've been blocked this way. I must keep on going and be persistent. Just like when you're pursuing, your degree. You have a bad class. Something bad happens in school. You don't stop or say, well, I made bad on that test, so I'm just gonna give up. You keep on going because you have an ultimate goal. And just like this man had an ultimate goal of being healed, and also his friends. I don't want that to get lost, that his friends also had that kind of faith, because his friends took him, you know, they brought him in and they brought him on the roof. They were also a faith. So your circle matters. The people you need to have, faithful people that also believe in your circle. That was one thing that, if you don't get anything else, I want you to know that you need to have faithful people in your circle. And verse 25 says, immediately he rose up before them and took up that whereon he lay and departed to his own house, glorifying God. So now he didn't, you know, drag himself up. He got up immediately and gathered his bed and he walked. He walked out of his house, and it said he glorified God. And this, with many Bible lessons, it says, and glorified God. And that's what we need to do. When God does something for us, we need to glorify him and praise his holy name, because what? That he is one, he's awesome, and he's done marvelous things for us. But two, we want the world to know. Want the world to know what he's done for us. So if you're celebrating and being glorious and glorifying God, people are going to want to, like, wasn't that the man over there that couldn't walk? And he's walking now. Wasn't that the person over there that didn't have a job but now has a job? And you telling God, you know, the many things that God has done for us. We need to always, what? Celebrate it, tell others about it. Because that's our witness, is what we're here for. You know, we're here for it, to spread the good news. In verse 26, and they were all amazed, and they glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, we have seen strange things this day. All right, so it had to be amazing. Like I said, we don't know how long the man had been paralyzed. We don't know how long he had been in that shape. But we now know that he has been what? Not only had his sins forgiven, but he's been healed physically. So this was amazing to everybody. They were like, oh my goodness. Did y'all just see that? Did y'all just see that? So they were amazed, but they also, it said, they glorified God, and they were all filled with fear. And it's not fear in a way where they are scared of it. It's like this man, Jesus, is not just a man. And that was what, and I think Jesus had to, that had to be, his reason for how he went about things. He needed to show the crowd there that he was not just a man. He was who he said he was. He had already told them that, you know, he was the Son of God, and that he was there. He was there to heal and heal the sick and raise the dead and those kind of things. And he had already shown that throughout his early ministry. But here, now, this crowd of witnesses, they've seen it. Because, you know, a lot of times, you know, faith is about the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But our faith comes from what? That's something that comes from the inside. You know, that's an internal thing. So these people, they needed, you know, they weren't of, a lot of them may not have been of the faith at the time. So they needed a visual, they needed to see something. They needed to see something. So these actual miracles, as we would term them, they needed to see an outward show of something that was supernatural. You know, like, I need to see to believe. We know faith is about believing without seeing. Like, we believe in a world to come. We believe in a Christ, in Jesus that we have not seen. But these people at the time needed to see. And so Jesus, like I said, he made these outward shows, these miracles that he did. And he didn't just do them just for that. But there was always a lesson, like I said, to have. And today's lesson is to have persistent faith. So we'll go to our conclusion. And our practical point for today is that persistent faith is oftentimes considered strange faith. Faith that allows us to look odd to others, but faith when realized that glorifies God. I can imagine that man, these people are wondering, you know, they're reasoning also in their head, what is he doing? You're like, you know, he's lame. There's nothing going to be able to be done about that. You know, no physical physician has done anything to this point. So, but we know that, you know, he had the faith that Jesus could heal him, and his friends had the faith that Jesus could heal him. And lastly, Jesus is calling us to have a consistent and persistent faith in him and what he can do. Like, we always know that Jesus is able to heal any ailment that we have. He's able to do anything that we, more than we can think. That's anything that we can ask or think. Those things Jesus is capable of. And we need to always keep in our minds that we need to be persistent in what we, in seeking God. When we have our low points, when we have points, when we have our doubts, we have our fears, we need to hold on to our faith. Hold on to our faith always. And that's our lesson for today. But we can always take advantage of the knowing that Jesus always can heal us, whether it be from a physical ailment, a mental ailment, and we, most importantly, spiritually, because that's what this man needed most of all. You know, everybody on the outside looked at, okay, he's paralyzed, he needs to be healed, but Jesus looked on the inner and saw, no, he needs his sins forgiven. He needs his sins forgiven more so than the physical. And he did both. But we need to make sure that our hearts are right and that we are right aligned spiritually. Let's close with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for all that you do. We thank you. We know that you're an awesome God. We know that you can heal, and we know that you can do what no other power can do. We thank you for giving us life, health, and strength, Lord. We ask you to be with us in this worship service and as we go on throughout the rest of this day and the rest of this week, Lord. We ask you to be with us. We thank you for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
church, as we prepare our hearts and minds for baptism. I'll be reading from Acts chapter 8, as Philip dealt with the eunuch. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise, and go toward the south unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went. And behold, a man, an Ethiopian, a eunuch of great authority, under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasures, and he had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot, reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither and him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah and said, Understandest thou what thou readest? And he said, How can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. The place of the scripture which he read was this: He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shears, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this, of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, See, here is water. What doeth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, If thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way. He went on his way, rejoicing. In Jesus Christ we stand. Amen. God bless you.
Take me to the water. Take me to the water. Be baptized. Take me to the water. Take me to the water. Take me to the water to be baptized.
We thank God for Mackay Carter. In obedience to heaven's command, and by the power vested in me by the great head of the church, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
None but the righteous, None but the righteous. None but the righteous shall see God.
We thank God for Mavis Perry. In obedience to heaven's command, and by the power vested in me by the great head of the church, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Take me to the water. Take me to the water. Take me to the water to be baptized.
We thank God for Jacob Perry in obedience to heaven's command. And by the power vested in me by the great head of the church, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Take me to the water. Take me to the water. Take me to the water to be baptized.
We thank God for Jackson Epps in obedience to heaven's command. And by the power vested in me by the great head of the church, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
To the water, take me to the water. Take me to the water to be baptized.
We thank God for Jadorian Reps in obedience to heaven's command. And by the power vested in me by the great head of the church, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
The water, take me to the water, take me to the water to be baptized.
We thank God for Brother Chase Cole in obedience to heaven's command, and by the power vested in me by the great head of the church, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Take me to the water. Take me to the water to be baptized.
We thank God for Ryland Darrington in obedience to heaven's command. And by the power vested in me by the great head of the church, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Take me to the water. Take me to the water. Take me to the water to be baptized.
baptized on this day. We thank God for those added to the kingdom. We thank God for Jesus Christ, amen, that he died for us, amen, that we might be able to come unto him. Amen. And so we bless his name today. We bless his name today. We bless his name today. Deacon Green is going to pray for us.
Eternal gracious Father, we thank you, Lord, for these candidates.
Yes, sir.
Lord, we ask, Lord, that you give them strength as they go on this journey. We ask you to watch over them, Lord God, and to be everything that they so need.
Yes, sir.
Lord, we thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, dear God. Thank you. Another one joining your kingdom. Thank you, dear God. We ask, Lord, that you watch over us, take care of us, and be whatever we so need.
Yes, sir.
In Jesus' name, we ask and pray. Amen.
Amen. And amen.
Thank you. It is with a great deal of pleasure that we welcome you here to Indian Creek on today. Without a doubt, the Word of God is our hope and it's a relevant answer to the living of these days. To all of you with us on today, those in the sanctuary in person, as well as those who are joining us virtually, our prayers that God will bless your heart as we worship today. We are a loving church that worships God and serves mankind.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns forever and ever. Our God is
a wonderful day to praise God. I like to look at everybody so you can look back into my eyes and understand that God is who he say he is. Amen? So let's be reminded of who we are in Christ Jesus. If you don't mind standing for the reading of scripture this morning, if you're able, go with me, if you will, to the book of Galatians. And just a reminder of who we are. Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 29. Galatians chapter 3. Verses 26 through 29. And the word of God reads, "For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all, we are all one in Christ Jesus. And if we be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." Amen. This is God's word for God's people in God's time. Amen. God bless you.
Let's pray. Most gracious and heavenly Father, as we come before you today, Father, we just come to you, Father, just bow down before you as humble as we know how, Father. Father, we come lifting and magnifying your name, Father, because we know that you're just so worthy. Worthy of the praise, worthy of the honor, and worthy of the glory right now, Father. Father, we just praise you because, yeah, Father, you've just been so good. You've just been so good, Father. We thank you for your love, Father. We thank you for your peace. You give us peace of mind, Father, in troubled times, Father. We just thank you right now, Father. Father, we just thank you for your love right now that you shed amongst one another, Father. We just thank you right now. We glorify you. We lift you up, Father. We just want to give you the highest praise because you are so worthy. Just so worthy, Father. When I was sick, Father, you healed me, Father. You're just so worthy. When I need a touch, Father, every now and then you just touch me, Father, just to let me know that you're there, Father. And I thank you right now, Father. And Father, as we come before you right now, we're praying right now that you just touch the sick right now. Touch them right now, Father. Heal when they need to be healed, Father. We're praying right now, Father, for those in sick homes, Father, those that are in nursing homes, Father. We pray that you just move by your spirit, Father, right now in your name. Father, we just come to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise, Father. We just come to give you all that, Father, you just done so much for us, Father. Father, we're just praying for your word today, Father, that it just go out with power, Father, that it just touch somebody's heart, Father, that they may come crying out, "What must I do to be saved?" right now. Father, we're just asking you to just help us to be, Father, more like you, Father, to walk more like you, Father, to just, Father, just do your will, Father. Take control, Father, right now in your name, Father. And as we go out this service, Father, we're just going to be so careful, Father, just to give your name the glory. So careful to give your name the honor and the praise because you're just so worthy, Father. You're just so worthy. I just can't say it enough, Father. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You're so worthy. And all these blessings we ask in the precious Son of Jesus, we're praying in the precious name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Good morning, Indian Creek. Good morning. What a blessing to see this beautiful day. Another day that the Lord has made. I don't know about you, but I'm gonna rejoice because I'm glad to be here. Amen. It is offering time at Indian Creek this morning. Amen. Come on, it's offering time at Indian Creek this morning. Amen. Amen. When we think about all the benefits and blessings that we have received, windows of heaven have been opened up and blessings have just fallen down upon us. How great it is. And all that is asked is that you give back 10 cents, as Pastor Rainey would say, a dime out of a dollar. Amen? Amen. You can give this morning through Givelify. We appreciate it. And you can also mail your offerings or tithes in to the number that is usually provided at the bottom of the screen. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal Father, we are thankful that you've allowed us to be here today. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to give. Father God, we just thank you for the gift and the givers. And we pray this prayer in the name of Jesus. And now we'll have the choir to sing and we will give.
Hallelujah.
say thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, Jay, yes, you are. Oh, Jay, yes, you are. Oh, Jay, yes, you are. Oh,
Creek Bible Study Academy is in progress each Wednesday at 6 p.m. The IC Bible Academy is a 6 weeks Bible study. There are two classes, Handling Disappointments, to be taught by Jennifer Henderson and Jermisha Barnes. This class will be in person and small group discussion format. And How to Have Strong Faith, taught by Eunice Scott and George King. This class will be in person and virtual. Our regular Wednesday night youth group runs concurrent with the academy. Please join us.
A little note of thanks. Pastor Rainey and our wonderful church family, we would like to thank all of you for your prayers, time, gifts, thoughtfulness, calls, and all you did to make his homegoing uplifting. We will be forever grateful for your love and kindness shown during our time of bereavement. The James Steele Family.
Say yes to Youth Evangelism Sunday on April 14th. Indian Creek Youth will be spreading the love of Jesus in Bridge Street on Sunday, April 14th at 12 p.m. In addition to wearing your Indian Creek Youth white polo or a white shirt to this evangelism event, youth are asked to wrap at least 10 unopened bottles of water with spiritual messages to be handed out. Labels with spiritual messages are available in the church lobby. Youth should pick up 10 labels and adhere them to their water bottles prior to arrival. The fun won't stop with spreading the word. Participating youth are invited to go bowling afterwards at Main Event in Bridge Street. Remember to say yes to Youth Evangelism Sunday, and we'll meet you at the water fountain in front of the movie theater at Bridge Street on April 14th at 12 p.m. For additional info, contact Youth Congress Chairpersons David and Quintessa Thomas or a Youth Congress officer.
Getting back to basics, Sunday School Matters. Youth, accept the challenge. Join us for Sunday School on April 14th. The class with the most attendees will host a party celebrating Jesus on April 21st during Sunday School. Let's celebrate Jesus. He is worthy to be celebrated.
Save the date. The Church Anniversary Committee invites everyone to celebrate our 155th year of service to God in the Huntsville community on May 5th at 10 a.m., in person and virtually. The guest preacher is Reverend Donald Smith, former pastor, Center Grove United Methodist Church, Huntsville. The colors for the occasion are rose, blush, and cream. Men, gray suits. Chairs, Brother Carl J. Cooney Jr. and Sister Clarissa Cooney.
Please see the bulletin for further announcements. Join us next Sunday for either in-person or virtual worship. A link will be emailed to you on Wednesday, and the link will also be posted on our Facebook page. Worship will begin at 10 a.m.
That concludes the announcements. As a reminder, please submit your church announcements by noon each Wednesday.
Won't you say amen? We thank God for our being here on today. We thank God for the announcements in our hearing. And as always, we are sure that you're going to adhere to them. Let me also take time out to thank our Resurrection Festival Committee for a wonderful job on last Saturday. Amen. Sister Sinead Lewis and Ashley Baum, what a great job you did on last Saturday. We also thank God for our Resurrection Program and that full committee and all that you did. Tangela Beasley, Crystal McGuire, Lanisha Leslie, Terry Armstrong for a wonderful job. Amen. Amen. Now, if you're not attending our IC Bible Academy, we want you to be here. Wednesday at 6 p.m., we're having a great time in the Word of God. Amen. Now, let me say also that this is a special day. 45 years ago, Sister Rainey said, I do. Amen. Amen. And we thank God for 45 years together. Sister Rainey is a backbone. She's a great help and pusher. And so I thank God for her. Amen. All of our first-time guests, why don't you stand? All of our first-time guests. Amen. Amen. Let me say to you that we thank God for you and your presence with us here on today. And we're believing that God has sent you our way, that you are not here by happenstance, but that God has something special in this house for you on this day. And we thank you for being with us on today and say, do come again. God bless you. Amen. Indian Creek, give them a warm Indian Creek welcome. Amen. Amen. At Indian Creek, we are believers in prayer. And right now, it is prayer time at Indian Creek. And we thank God for this communication that we can have with the Almighty God. Because the Bible says when we pray, that God hears our prayers. We are not just saying words, but God actually hears us in heaven. And not only does he hear us, but he also responds to us. And so we thank God for our prayer. And all of you who stand in need of prayer today, we want you to assemble around the altar. We are certainly believing that whatever we need, whatever our hurts, our pains, our concerns, that God is aware, but the more we petition him, the more he comes to our need. We want to pray for all of those who are scheduled for surgery, all of those who are sick among us, all of those who are bereaved among us. We want to pray that God answers every need that we have. And I believe that if we are sincere in our prayers, if our hearts are right, that God actually will respond. And he can respond immediately. It doesn't take long, but he's already here. And so since he's here, he can work on our behalf. Minister Epps would pray for us.
Let us pray, church. Master, we're your people. Lord, yet broken, even the prayer that's praying out loud now, Lord, broken. But Lord, we believe in you. Our trust, our hope, our faith is in you, Jesus. Lord, there are those of us who are in the sound of this voice, Lord, who are grieving right now, Jesus. who've lost loved ones, oh Lord. Lord, issues have seemed like it has turned against them, Lord. But Master, we know that, God, you are a God of compassion, Jesus. Lord, you know our heart, you know our hurt. Lord, you know what we can stand and what we can't stand. Lord, there are those that are among us, oh Master. Lord, who are ill, sick. Oh Lord, those who are taking care, Lord, the sick, Lord, the shut in, oh Father. Lord, we just asking God, Lord, give us an understanding, Lord, of where you are. Lord, it's just a part of our failing condition, oh Lord, that we feel like you're not there. That's all, Jesus, but we know you're there, Lord. Your Holy Spirit is here with us. And Master, we're just asking Jesus to just touch us and just say, hey, I'm still here. Let us know, hey, I'm still working in your favor. Hey, I'm still carrying you through your challenges, through your trials. Hey, I'm still here looking after you, being your comforter when you need company. I'm still here to be your security when you can't secure yourself, when you can't secure your children, when you can't secure your family. I'm still here. Jesus is still here. His spirit yet lingers here. All we need to do is just humble ourselves unto him, be servants unto him, believe in him. And he'll make everything all right. He may not take the issue away, but he can take you and surround you within your circumstance, and you will not even know that you're in it. That's how good a God we serve. He's our God. And if you're troubled at work or in the schoolhouse, and you don't know who to turn to, it's all right to be a little fanatic and say, Jesus, help me. If they send you to the principal's office, just say, Jesus. It's all right, Lord, we trust you. And we thank you for being our God. You let us know in the scriptures we are heir to the kingdom of glory. And we thank you for that. Lord, David prayed, Daniel prayed, the Hebrew boys prayed, Lord, Jesus prayed, Lord, so we're crying out unto you right now. Hear every heart, every mind, every whisper. Lord, we need you, and we're trusting and believing in you. We know that you're going to answer. We are your people. Yet fallen, yet broken, but Lord, you loved us because it's evident. You came down from heaven. You walked this whole earth. You shedded your blood on Calvary's cross. You went down to the grave and you got up early. You got up early with all power and with all authority. And you are coming back. Lord, we trust in you. We thank you for your paraclete that's here right now, that we trust, live, love, and believe in you. It is in your name, Jesus Christ. I count every petition, every prayer, every question. I count it done. I count it done in your name. In the name of Jesus. Everybody say, Jesus. One more time, say, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I count it done. I said, thank you, Father, that we may all say amen, amen, and amen.
Thank you.
the morning, in the evening, all day long. Singing, mine in the morning, mine in the evening, all the day long. Singing, Jesus is mine. He's truly mine. Everywhere I go. Something about that name, yeah.
Something about that name, yeah.
There's something about that name, yeah.
Something about that name, yeah.
Ooh. Ooh. Oh my God.
Oh my God.
Something about that name, yeah.
Something about that name, yeah.
There's something about that name, yeah.
Something about that name, yeah.
There's something about that name, yeah.
Something about that name, yeah.
Because. Something about that name, yeah.
Something about that
name, yeah. Won't you say amen? Something about that name. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess at his name. When you've said his name, you've already said enough. There's healing in his name. There's help in his name. There's every need in his name. Amen. Let us pray. God, how we thank you now for this moment of preaching. Give us now words and power that come from you. Open the ears of the listeners. God, have your way in this place. We pray in the strong and sufficient name of him who is our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Now this morning, let me call your attention to the book of Acts. And we're concerned with that story found Acts 3, verses 1 through 8. Hear the word of God. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the hand, the right hand, and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Amen. Now, from those said words, I want to talk about how to overcome what's holding you down. How to overcome what's holding you down. This is one of the Bible's most familiar stories. We know it by many names. To some, it is the man at the beautiful gate, or the lame man healed. To others, it is called the healing of the beggar, or an apostolic miracle. But one thing is sure about this story is that the man asking for alms did not get what he asked for. Some years ago, there was an article published under the title of Asking, 21 Ways to Ask for What You Want and Get It. It said, if you don't ask, the answer is already no. But it says, when you do ask, there are some definite things that you ought to keep in mind. Here are a few of them. The article says, be direct, clear, and specific about what you want. Make it ridiculously clear what you're asking for. It says, ask multiple ways, multiple times. It says, be audacious. It said, keep it simple. And here is one of particular interest. It said, master the pause. The article said, and this is most important, stop talking and just wait. Don't throw a bunch of unnecessary words into the space between your asking and the person's response. It says, now the waiting part, that silence, the article says, is deafening but critical. But in this text, this lame man, perhaps a skilled beggar, didn't get what he asked for. And that is so because oftentimes we fail to ask for what we really need. This man didn't need a dollar. He needed deliverance. He didn't need money. He needed a miracle. Aren't you glad that God doesn't give us everything we ask for? Because sometimes we ask for, though we think it is to our good, it can hurt and hinder us. It can stifle and stall us. Here before us today, this man needed a healing of his condition. This man was a paraplegic, cripple. And if the truth be told, everybody is crippled by something. Everybody has something they need to be delivered from. Everybody has something in life that they need to be healed of, something that pulls us down, whether it be physical, spiritual, emotional, mental, social, everybody has something. And here in this text today, it suggests to us how we can become overcomers. And in order to make that happen, there are certain things that we shouldn't do. Very often there are lessons that can be taught based on what not to do. And we see it here. We see it here. We see it in the life of this lame man. And one of the don'ts that we can gather from this text is this: don't give in to complacency. If you want to be an overcomer, if you want to hold on, don't give in to complacency. I want you to take a close look at this lame man before us today. The text says, and a certain man, lame from his mother's womb. Now I need you to grasp this man's condition. This man was not just lame, but he was lame from his mother's womb. Crippled in the cradle. It was all that he had ever known. Never in his entire life had he stood unaided on his own two feet. And because of that, this man had no means of livelihood. He was unable to work. This man was unable to provide bed and bread. This man was a paraplegic. He was a beggar. And I want to submit to you that this man got comfortable in his predicament. He's seated at the beautiful gate begging. Listen to him, sir, master, can you spare a denarius? Do you have a shekel? Can you spare a mite? Anything. Help me, anything. It was routine. It was comfortable. The scripture says he was carried and laid each day at the main entrance to the temple at Jerusalem. And I'm not talking about every day for a few weeks or a few months, but every day for years. Acts 4 and 22 says this man was above 40 years old. And so for 10, 20, 30 years, his friends had brought him, carried him to the entrance of the temple and had carted him up 15 steps to the largest and most traveled gate. And can't you hear him saying, this is all there is for me. After all of these years, can't you see him settling into his dilemma? Can't you see him saying, this is the way it shall always be? Never mind thinking there could be more. He was complacent. Let me tell you here what complacency is. Complacency is a sense of calm satisfaction that prevents you from trying harder. You just unmotivated to strive for better, unwilling to strive for the next level. Perhaps I should pause here momentarily and tell you there's a difference between complacency and contentment. It's a difference. It is said with complacency, good enough becomes today's watchword and tomorrow's standard. But contentment is to say, I can deal with where I am, but I'm not stuck where I am. Paul wrote, I have learned whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. But listen to what he says in that same Philippian lesson. He says, I'm pressing on. What a difference it makes. We must never be at the point where we think there cannot be more. I call into memory one Helen Keller, who was deaf and blind. But with extraordinary accomplishments, she became a graduate of Red Cliff College. She became a renowned and prominent author. She didn't wallow in her condition, but said, there is more for me. She learned to feel objects and associate them with words. She learned to lip read by placing her finger on the lips and the throat of speakers. She learned to speak and became a noted, sought after lecturer. And this is what it says to us. Never settle where you are. There is more. We must not become comfortable. Whatever it may be. Let me say again, everybody is crippled by something. Don't let past failure keep you down. Don't let past hurt keep you down. Don't let mistakes keep you down. Don't let the hand you've been dealt keep you down. There is a God somewhere. And he knows about us, and he cares about us. You don't have to stay in the shape that you're in. But when we look here, this lame man is comfortable in routine at the beautiful gate. Sir, master, can you spare a denarius? Can you give me a shekel, half a shekel? Can you give me a mite, anything? What can you give? In his mind, his condition is painfully permanent. He is complacent, settled. But God wants us to know that there's much more. I keep reading in my Bible where it says that God can do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. And so here today, how do we overcome what's holding us down? Don't give in to complacency. Here's another thing. Don't make a request for a temporary fix. This man wanted silver and gold. For this man, money was a temporary fix. Because this is what it did. It helped him in his condition, but not out of his condition. It didn't matter how many dollar bills were placed at his feet. It only helped him in his condition. Because the very next day, this man's friend, family, would have to pick him up again and carry him to the city gates, bring him to the outer entrance of the temple, cart him again up 15 steps, and this man would have to begin afresh soliciting help for one more day. God is in the business of helping us out of our condition. In our text, a dollar, a denarius, a dime can only go so far, but a real fix comes from God. Let me bring it a little closer. When you visit the hospital, on every floor, there are many rooms occupied by those who are in medical need. Money can buy you a room, but it can't buy you mercy. Money can buy you a bed, but it can't buy you health. Money can buy you medicine, but it can't buy you a cure. Can I tell you again, there is a God somewhere. And our God is not in the business of temporary fixes. This is what our God does. He fixes what is broken. Can I tell you, he's done it before. He's done it before. Nowhere in the Bible do I read where God did a temporary miracle. When that leper in Mark 1 sought to be healed of leprosy, Jesus said these words, I will, be thou clean. And it was done. It was done. This former leper didn't have to keep coming back. When the blind man in John 9 was healed, this is what Jesus did. He spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and anointed this man's eyes. And this man was given sight, not for a week, not for a month or a year, but from then on. In Mark 3, when Jesus saw the man with the withered hand, Jesus said, stretch forth thine hands. And this man's hands were healed, never to have that condition come upon him again. God is in the business of helping us out of our condition. And here today, There are some vices and some situations that cripple us. There is something in our lives that have us going in a downward spiral, and we keep throwing temporary fixes at them. We keep asking many times for the wrong thing, temporary solutions. But we must bear in mind where real solutions come from. The Bible says that my God shall supply all of my needs. Yeah, that's all of my needs. And you have to notice here when it says all of my need doesn't have an S on it. It just says supply all of my need, because my first need is Jesus. And when I've got Jesus, I've got everything else that I need. But here, take another look at this man at the beautiful gate. He lives from day to day. Listen to him. Sir, mister, can you spare a denarius? Can you give me a shekel or half a shekel? Can you spare a mite? Anything that you can yield. Sometimes we ask for what will pacify but not satisfy. And so here it is. Here it is. If we're going to overcome what beset us, don't give in to complacency. Don't make a request for a temporary fix. And let me say also, don't forget the power of faith. After this lame man at the beautiful gate that begged and begged, there is a shift in this text. The Bible said Peter fastened his eyes on this man and said, look on us. And then Peter said, I don't have a temporary fix, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And now bear in mind here, this man was crippled from the crib. He had never known what it is to walk. He had never known what it was to put one foot before the other. He had never known what it was like to rest his weight on his legs. But here Peter, under the power of the Holy Spirit, takes him by the hand. And with his hand and Peter's hand, this man had to muster up some strong faith. His hand in Peter's hand, Peter lifts him up, and the Bible says immediately his feet and ankles received strength. Verse 8, and instantaneously, immediately he began to walk. Faith. Faith. Now get this. Not only is he walking, but the text says, leaping. Watch him here. He didn't even proceed. You know, he didn't even proceed with caution. He didn't even take one careful step after the other. But the Bible says he's leaping and walking, and look at where he's going. The Bible says he's walking and leaping and praising God as he entered the temple of God. Faith. 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 If you can have the faith of a mustard seed. Faith. If you can have that kind of faith that can move mountains. Faith. If we have that kind of faith, let me tell you what you have to do. You just have to believe. You have to believe that there is a greater power. You have to believe in miracles. You have to believe in what you cannot see. For we walk by faith, not by sight. You have to believe in mountain-moving faith. You have to believe that God can do the impossible. You have to believe in signs and wonders. You have to believe in the name of Jesus. Listen to Peter here. This he says to the paraplegic, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Listen to that again. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And by faith, he got up in Jesus' name, walking physically and spiritually, walking in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, it's something about that name. It's something about that name. His name. His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God. His name, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do. His name, kings and kingdoms shall all pass away, but there's something about that name. We conquer what comes against us in that name. We come through our crisis in that name. We claim our breakthroughs in that name. There's something, something about that name. We receive mercy in that name. We receive miracles in that name. We receive mighty works in that name. Something, something about that name. Yes, we overcome burdens in that name. We overcome what cripples us in that name. Yes, we get up and we walk in that name. Yes, yes, blessed be his name, a mighty name.
Oh, praise his name. Oh, praise his name.
Extend to you the invitation for Christian discipleship. There very well may be one here today, and you need Jesus Christ in your life. You need a Savior. And if you need a Savior, I want to recommend Jesus. And so wherever you are here today, we declare that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he died on the cross for us. But death could keep him or hold him. He got up. And that Jesus is available to you today. Will you come? If you're here today, will you come? Will you come unto him? Will you give Jesus your heart? Will you give Jesus your life? Will you come? For those who are joining us virtually, there's a number at the bottom of your screen. If you call that number, we'll be sure and get back with you on today. And so if you're here, will you come? Will you come? Will you come? God bless you. God bless you.